Chapter 9, The Last Patient. "I must try again to get her to tell me the truth." The words fell like lead upon my mind and left me half stunned with horror. Before I could utter a word, he spoke again. "Don't ask me any more questions. Don't try to find out, and don't follow me. I'm going to see her now." He sprang up from his seat on the bench before he had finished speaking, and without giving me time for a word of protest, he rushed away across the park. I did not attempt to follow him. I was, in fact, incapable of doing so. I sank back upon my bench and closed my eyes, trying to steady the world that was reeling round me. How long I sat there I do not know, probably for the better part of an hour. Then, summoning all my resolution, I got up and walked slowly back to the Worth Street station in the subway, and there took a train uptown. There was no doubt about my destination. There was only one place where I could go. Before I should see or talk with anyone else, before I dared allow my thought even to follow the suspicions which Jack Marshall's hard words had reawakened, I must see Madeline myself again and talk with her. She received me after a little delay in the same room, the big dim library, whither Jack had conducted me for the first time a little less than 24 hours ago. She wore the same lavender-colored house frock she had worn on that occasion, but this time when she entered, she did not go over to the wall switch and flood the room with light. She sank, rather wearily, into a big chair and motioned me into another at the other side of the hearth. "Madeline," said I. She interrupted me. "Let me say something first. I am glad you have come. I hope you will stay to dinner. It seems good to have you here somehow. But please, let's not talk about anything that concerns these last two dreadful days. Let's talk about old times." Her words made my task 10 times harder. I rose miserably to my feet. "Has Jack come home?" I asked. "I think not," she said. "At least I have not seen him. I missed you as I came out from the inquest, and when I turned to look for you, I thought I saw you going off with him." "You did," said I, "but he left me abruptly, and I thought he meant to come straight home." There was a little silence after that. She waited for me to speak, and finally I began. "Madeline," said I, "I wish with all my heart that we could do as you say, forget for a while these dreadful days and talk about old times. But there is something else that must come first. Before Jack left me this afternoon, he told me something that did not come out at the inquest, and I must talk to you about it. I have no alternative." She sighed wearily. "Very well, then," she said. "Jack told me," I began, "that Dr. Armstrong is innocent." "Well, I think so too," she said. "My belief in that was not shaken by the inquest, at least. I am glad Jack agrees with me." "Jack is not glad," said I gravely. "He's in despair. He told me that he would give anything, his life, he thought, to be rid of the knowledge that convinces him that Dr. Armstrong is innocent." She started and looked at me intently. "What do you mean?" she asked. "Jack knows," I went on, looking at her intently. "Jack knows who it was who came out of Dr. Marshall's office at 12:20 on the day of the murder. It was a woman." Madeline dropped back rather limply in her chair. "Oh, the poor, poor boy," she said, half under her breath. Then she asked me a question. "Did Jack tell you who it was that he saw?" "No," said I. "He said he meant to see her again and try to get her to tell the truth." The expression in Madeline's face hardened suddenly. "And you think," she observed, a world of scornful anger in her voice, "you think it was I who came out of the office at that hour?" "I have not said so," I protested. "I have accused you of nothing." "Don't quibble," she said. "As a matter of fact, you did say you suspected me, though you didn't mean to. You said just now that Jack left you to see the woman and to try to get her to tell the truth, and you said 5 minutes ago that you suspected he had come straight home. That makes it clear enough, I think, what you are thinking of. I am not sure that you really deserve an answer, but I will make you one. I did not come out of Dr. Marshall's office at 12:20 or at any other time on the day of the murder, for the simple reason that I didn't go into it on that day." "Well," said I gravely, "I am very, very glad. I did think from the way Jack spoke that it was you he saw, and I think in time you will forgive me for having thought so natural a thing." "Oh, I forgive you now," she said half-heartedly, "but I find it a little difficult. I suppose I should not blame my friends for having suspected me of having murdered my husband, when the circumstances really point in that direction. But I think I have a right to expect that they use a little ordinary reason in the matter. Why, Clifford Drew, do you suppose after all the evidence at the inquest that Jack would feel that Dr. Armstrong's innocence was established beyond a doubt by the fact that I came out of the doctor's office at 12:20? Wouldn't that implicate him all the more deeply, if anything?" The sudden truth of what she said left me speechless. I was 7 times a fool not to have seen it when I sat there in the park, seen it, and rejoiced instead of dolefully imagining that the world was coming to an end. "Come, don't worry about it," she said at length. "You meant all right, and we are all so tired and so dazed that we are hardly responsible. But poor, poor Jack." "Do you know who it was he saw?" I asked. "No, I don't know." "But you can guess?" "I could make a guess that might or might not be right, but I don't mean to do it." "Well," said I feel that I must do something. The position of leaving an innocent man locked up in the Tombs under the weight of such an appalling amount of circumstantial evidence as has been piled upon Dr. Armstrong is intolerable." "I shan't say another word about it," she said positively. "If you want to accept the terms I first proposed when I came down to see you, and sit here quietly till Jack comes home, you may. Otherwise, I shall have to ask you to go. When Jack comes in, he will probably be able to clear everything up. As for Dr. Armstrong, I don't think he will mind spending an evening, or even a day or two, in a nice, comfortable cell where he can't be pestered. I wish I were in one myself." I accepted her terms somewhat sulkily, but even when they were accepted, the subject of conversation didn't get very far away from the dreadful mystery that enveloped us. We got farthest away from it when she told me the story of the man whom Dr. Marshall had ruined years ago, just as he had meant to ruin this man now. I meant to stay until Jack came home, but when the big hall clock struck 8, I gave it up. He might have gone to my rooms anyway and be waiting for me there. In case he came home at any reasonable hour, I left word that I was to be telephoned for. I picked up a hasty dinner in a restaurant on the way down to the Atlas, and, arriving there, went straight to Jeffrey's rooms. I opened my own door into the corridor and left it ajar, so that I could hear the telephone when it rang. Then I settled down to talk it out with Jeffrey. In the web of perplexity in which I was then involved, it was a downright necessity to me to talk over the whole affair with someone in whom I could place implicit confidence. There was a good deal that I wanted to say, wanted him to hear, and I had talked for some time before I began gradually to become aware that he was unusually silent, if not absolutely indifferent. "After all, she was quite tired out," he said at last, after I had described at some length my unsatisfactory interview with Madeline. "Anyway, so far as I can see, she gave you all you had a right to ask for. in the assurance that she didn't know whom Jack meant by her. If you pressed her for more than that, I don't wonder she quarreled with you. Oh, we didn't quarrel exactly, but I think she might have tried to help. Certainly she could have offered some suggestion.
She has known that boy very well in the last 2 years.
Better in some ways than his own mother could have known him, and she must have been able to offer some hint. Not necessarily. And even though she could, what good would a hint do, and what harm is done by waiting? Oh, I know, an innocent man will spend the night in the tombs, but there are plenty more innocent men in there to keep him company, and plenty of guilty ones outside for company to the murderer, whoever he is. It's all very well for you to take that detached view of it, said I, because it doesn't matter a tallow dip to you, one way or the other. But I happen to care. I have too much regard for Madeline herself to feel comfortable leaving her under suspicion that way.
Leaving who under suspicion? Geoffrey demanded.
Then, as I was too much surprised by the open anger in his voice to answer immediately, he went on.
Why, you silly ass, do you mean that you suspect that Madeline Marshall was the person who came out of the office at 12:20?
On the contrary, I am convinced she was not, said I stiffly, for his manner had really been offensive. But no one of ordinary intelligence could help seeing that suspicion will attach to her until Dr. Armstrong is cleared. No one with a grain of imagination who had ever looked her straight in the face would entertain such a suspicion. You seem to think you are living in the days of the early Italian Renaissance. You'd better go to bed and sleep it off.
He tried to say it with an air of good humor and banter, but was powerless to disguise the fact that he was both in earnest and angry. Even if I haven't much imagination, I could see that. And I happened to see something else, too, something that a man, who cared as little for appearances as he professed to, would hardly have tried to hide. There was a note on his table, of which only a corner of the envelope was visible, projecting out from under a folded evening paper that had been laid down over it. I happened to brush against the table as I was leaving the room, and the note fell to the floor. It was exactly at my feet, so I stooped to pick it up in spite of the "never mind," which Geoffrey uttered casually enough when he saw what had happened. The note was addressed to Geoffrey, and it was in Madeline Marshall's handwriting. I went across to my own apartment, shut the door behind me, and sat down to think. Why, I asked myself, need this black web of suspicion and mystery spread itself over one after another of my friends? That it should include Jack and Madeline was bad enough, but when it stretched to cover Arthur Geoffrey, too, this was the last straw. There was absolutely nothing tangible against him, of course. It was nothing that he had received a note from Madeline. I shouldn't want to be suspected on similar grounds myself. But he had deliberately kept me in the dark, was still keeping me in the dark, and I felt that he had become impossible as a confidant until he should be willing to give me his confidence too. And I did want somebody to tell my story to. It would clarify itself just in the telling, I felt sure. The thought of the actor, Carlton Stancliffe, had occurred to me a good many times during the day. I recalled his interest in the case, the valuable hint he had given me as to the counterfeit nature of Pomeroy's ruby, and remembered that he had admitted having a theory of his own for the case. On the impulse of the moment, I looked up his address on the card he had given me and called him over the telephone. My call was answered, and I had asked that Mr. Stancliffe be summoned to the phone before the inconsiderateness of the act occurred to me. Of course, without a voice, he could hardly be expected to talk to me. So I was a good deal surprised to hear it, rich and full, coming to me here through the receiver. I asked him if he would mind letting me talk over some new aspects of the Marshall case with him, and offered to go to his quarters if he would receive me.
"I am afraid you wouldn't find them very comfortable," he said, "but I'll be glad to come to see you."
Upon that understanding, I ordered up a siphon and some ice, and got out a square bottle and some cigars. He lived not far away, and it was less than 10 minutes before I heard his ring. I felt a certain return of confidence, quietness, and poise come to me, just with the sight of him. His voice lasted through the first few words of his greeting, and then apparently left him for good. I soon got used to the whisper, however, and forgot it. I put him into my easiest chair, and told him, under the stimulus of his grave, keen attention, and a whispered question here and there, the whole story, so far as I knew it, of the last 24 hours, and of the events that had led up to it.
"I am rather interested," he observed at last, "in what you tell me of the other man, the doctor, whom Mrs. Marshall says her husband ruined years ago. Tell me all you can about him. In the first place, did she say quite definitely that he was dead?"
"No," said I thoughtfully. "She spoke as if he was dead, spoke of it rather bitterly and with a good deal of personal feeling. It was not through her husband that she knew about it. It seems that he, James Hyde, his name was a sort of cousin of her own, a good deal older, but not too old for a romantic young girl to take an interest in. He was an extremely handsome man, she says, with a great charm of manner. From her description, he had a most brilliant mind, which he could turn to anything, although he had a special genius for medicine. He was guilty, it seems, of little worse than an indiscretion, talking about some patient of his, I believe, in a way that was unprofessional, perhaps, but not malicious, and Dr. Marshall simply hounded him out of the city. Pushed him down off the curve of the world, was the way she put it. And now I remember what she said about his death. She said she did not know in what miserable slough of despair he might have perished. Evidently, the incident made a lasting impression on her mind, for she had taunted her husband with it on the very morning of his death, and she talked about it at considerable length to me this evening. But her belief in Hyde's death is evidently based on pure assumption." Our conversation got diverted just then, owing to a little accident. A careless motion of his arm knocked the siphon off the little tabouret that stood beside his chair and broke it, and the moment of mild excitement which this provided us with had the curious effect of restoring his voice. It was he who commented on the fact. "It always acts that way," he said. "I can speak perfectly well through the telephone if the conversation doesn't last too long. The affection is purely nervous. It has nothing to do with the organs of the throat themselves. It is my firm belief that if I could get the chance, I should be able to play my parts on the stage just as well as ever. But, of course, it is absurd to expect any manager to risk it."
"But does an actor's excitement last after the first minute or two?" I asked.
"Excitement is hardly the word for it. There is an increase in the nervous tension. I think the mere effort involved in keeping myself in another character than my own would prevent my voice from failing me."
"Isn't there a chance of your getting some manager to risk it?" He shook his head.
"Not the least in the world. I must find some other way of making a living, some way that the possession of a voice is not essential to. Then perhaps when I don't want it, it will come back again. But that's enough about me. Let's go back to our mystery."
"Do you think," I asked, "that there may be something in the theory that this doctor, whom he ruined, has come back after all these years and avenged himself upon him?" Of course, I was merely echoing the thought that I knew was in Mr. Stancliffe's mind, but I wanted him to develop the idea more thoroughly. It made it seem rather promising.
"I don't know," he said very thoughtfully, after a little silence. "They testified, if the newspaper reports of the inquest are correct, that the murder had, in all probability, been committed by a doctor. The coroner's physician, in fact,
spoke of it as a surgical operation rather than a murder. But the other theory, especially in view of what young Marshall told you, the woman theory, seems better. Unless Dr. Marshall was deliberately submitting to an examination by a doctor, no man could have got around behind his chair and touched his face with his hands. Going farther than that, the very first faint prick of steel, unless it were expected, would have caused an instantaneous resistance. But those difficulties quite shortly disappear if you adopt the theory that it was a woman. She might have got behind the doctor's chair, have touched his face with her hands by way of a caress, and the imperceptible instant during which he might have jerked away would have been lost. He would have accounted for the prick with the thought of a pin in the waistband, perhaps. His whole attitude of mind and body, at least, would have been quite different with a woman behind him, a charming and attractive one, say, than with a man. On the whole, I think that counteracts the presumption established by the apparent knowledge of the location of the jugular vein. "Do you mean his wife?" I asked. "No," he said. "I mean the woman we know was in the office with him, the girl who testified she went out at 12:20. "You mean the last patient?" I cried. "Gwendolyn Carr, a slender, frail little thing like that?" "This wasn't a crime of violence. That's the very essence of it. Sandown never could have accomplished it, because his purpose would have been frustrated by the faintest resistance. The very prettiness and innocence and charm which seems to have made such an impression on you would be worth more in a crime like that than the strength of 20 men." "Well," I confessed rather ruefully, "I have suspected nearly everybody, but it never occurred to me to think of her." "That's because all the testimony had so obvious a direction. When you look at the case without prejudice, there's a good deal of ground for suspicion against her. She is the last person known to have seen him alive in the first place. And in the second place, there was an obvious lack of candor about her testimony at the inquest."
"It wasn't obvious to me," said I.
"Oh, but you weren't looking. Do you remember when the coroner asked her if her visit to the doctor was of a professional character? This was her answer. 'Do you mean did I go as a patient?' 'Yes, sir.' Of course she went as a patient. She took her place in the line of the reception room and waited her turn. If the doctor had already refused to see her on any other terms, this would afford her an easy means of access to him, the only means, very likely, unless she wanted to make a scene somewhere, and she doesn't seem to be the kind of person to do that."
"It seems to me you are attributing a curious confusion to her character in supposing that she would be willing to murder a man in cold blood, and yet would risk an equivocation instead of a downright lie when questioned about it."
"Women are like that," he said. "And then, too, God knows the poor thing may have been justified." I took 10 minutes or so to digesting that theory in silence. It was utterly new to me, utterly repugnant to my instincts to entertain it, and yet, in many ways, it seemed to square remarkably with the facts. Suddenly, however, I thought of something.
"But there's Jack," I cried. "Where does he come in? If he had happened to see her coming out of his father's office at 12:20, instead of 20 minutes before, as she testified, what in the world could keep him from saying so?" But I saw the answer before Mr. Stancliffe's whispering voice could put it into words.
"Suppose Jack knew," he answered, "knew something, no matter what, that involved this girl to his father's discredit. Wouldn't he hold back that knowledge as long as he could?"
His question clearly needed no answer, and I made none, but sat thoughtfully silent, with my chin in my hands, turning over in my mind this new and disquieting angle which the case had taken. There are a few minor points that are also worthy of consideration. In the first place, while her speech and manner are those of a person of education and refinement, her dress is not that of a young woman of wealth. It is inconspicuous and shows a considerable regard for economy. You must permit me, as an actor, to speak in such matters as one having authority. She gives her address as the Saint Anthony, a person who found it necessary to economize in matters of dress, would hardly be living at the newest and most luxurious hotel in New York. She would not be likely to go to consult Dr. Marshall professionally. If she comes from out of town and is only a transient at that hotel, she would have someone with her. She would not have gone alone to the doctor's office. I have just this much more to add. Remember that I was in Dr. Marshall's waiting room myself that morning. She was only 3 or 4 behind me in the line of waiting patients, and I had a good chance to observe her. It occurred to me at the time that I could not ask an actress better to portray a strong, self-contained, well-bred young woman waiting for the beginning of what must prove a painful scene than this Miss Gwendolyn Carr did while I sat there watching her.
The telephone bell rang just then. It was the call I had been expecting, but had forgotten. Madeline herself was on the wire. "Jack came in about an hour ago," she said. "He must have been having a fearful time. He was mud-stained and exhausted, and in a raging fever. He is delirious now. I am afraid he is going to be seriously ill." When she had rung off, I told Mr. Stancliffe the upshot of our conversation. "So there will be nothing to be got from him for an indefinite time. What do you say to our going up to the St. Anthony and seeing Miss Carr ourselves?"
"We shall be too late to find her," said Mr. Stancliffe, "but we may as well go up there and see what we can find out about her."
"Why do you think we shall be too late?" I asked.
"I suspected it before, but Mrs. Marshall's message made me sure of it. It was undoubtedly this Miss Gwendolyn Carr whom Jack went to see, undoubtedly, that is, unless our whole theory of the case is wrong. Well, he couldn't have got into the mud between the St. Anthony and his own house. She's gone away to some one of the suburbs. You may take my word for it."
We put on our hats, however, lighted fresh cigars, and set out for the St. Anthony. It was I who walked up to the clerk to make our inquiry. "Is Miss Gwendolyn Carr stopping here?" I asked. His face was wooden enough already, but at the sound of that name it turned perfectly expressionless.
"Not here," he said.
"Can you tell me when she left?"
"Never been here, I think," he said. "Look at the register, if you like."
I didn't believe him. At least I was sure that the name was familiar to him, and that he could probably have told me more than he did. But I saw nothing better to do than to open the register and begin to turn over the pages. After spending a few minutes at this profitless occupation, I felt a touch on my elbow.
"Come," said Mr. Stancliffe. "I always begin to feel the need of a shave about this time in the evening. Let's go down to the barber shop."
I had no idea what he was driving at, and he would not tell me, but I was not kept waiting very long. The moment he settled down in the first barber's chair, he gave his head a knowing nod in the direction of the manicurist's table in the corner.
"Got a new one, I see," he said.
"You knew her, did you?" asked the barber, with a look of perfect comprehension. Mr. Stancliffe nodded indifferently.
"What's become of her?" he asked.
"Search me," said the barber. "She got the sack from here when she gave this hotel as her address at the coroner's inquest in the Marshall case. It happened to be true she did live here, but that excuse didn't go down with the management. She had orders to pack up as soon as they read the evening papers."
"You don't happen to know where she's gone?"
The barber waved his hand.
"Somewhere between Hackensack and Staten Island, I should say. I can't do better than that."
End of chapter 9.